writer of Ephesians proclaims that God has a dream for us, a dream that has been set in motion by Christ Jesus, a dream for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. These opening words we heard in Ephesians, these 12 verses are structurally, in the original Greek, one sentence. Like water bubbling up out of a stream. They just keep on coming. Words flowing up and over one another exuberantly. They are not logically ordered. They just burst forth as if they cannot be contained. The love and goodness of God not being able to be bottled up. And the intention for that love and goodness to be shared with all peoples is clearly the vision God has shared with the writer of this song of praise, this hymn of grace, which wants, it needs to include everything. That's why it just keeps coming. Include everything for which the lyricist has to be grateful. It was Aldous Huxley who said this. He said, after silence, that which comes the nearest to expressing the inexpressible is music. You may be familiar with Robert Fulton, who loves to tell stories. In his book, it's either his first book or one of his first books, All I Really Needed to Know I Learned in Kindergarten. Does anybody know that one? He shared an experience that particularly moved him. He wrote that every single year he spent a week in a little town in Idaho. Some of you know the name of this town, right? A town of about 4,000 people. A place where very little of import ever happened, except for that one week every year when it becomes the home of the Grand National Old Time Fiddlers Contest, right? Fulton told in his story how people had come and still do come from all over the United States and even all over the world. They played fiddles, they sang, and they had a really good time. He writes that when he first began going, the fiddlers were pretty straight country folk. They were men with short hair, women who stayed home and cooked wonderful meals, and everybody, absolutely everybody, went to church on Sunday. Right? But then he says, after some years, the convention kind of changed. Long hairs showed up, some of whom could play the fiddle also and sing. People with tattoos and leather jackets riding on motorcycles came, and some of them played fiddles too. And they sang. And Fulton asked one of the old timers what he thought about this new crowd. And that old timer said, I don't care who they are or how they look. It don't matter. If you can fiddle, you're all right with me. It's the music we make that counts. I love his writing. Whether Paul wrote this letter of Ephesians from a Roman prison cell, which some scholars believe, or whether one of his disciples wrote it in his name to summarize some of his theology, it was presented as a vision of the way that things could be. In the middle of a divided and broken world, there could, the writer is proclaiming, be a church where all people come despite their differences, where they could find a safe house, where they could find healing for their brokenness. These verses carry the melody that will run throughout the whole book of Ephesians, like truth as melody. Like the fiddlers in that little town in Idaho, it was the music they made that mattered. The early church appears to have embraced this vision. for the prayers and the songs and the sermons that we find that have survived from way back then. They all preserved the words of Ephesians. If you look in our hymns, a lot of them have words from Ephesians. What does all this music talk have to do with us? Ralph Vaughan Williams, a fine English composer, when he was asked if he could do everything all over again, what would he do? He said, music. But he said, in the next world, I shall not be doing music with all its strivings and disappointments. I shall be being it. How can we as the church be the music? The writer of Ephesians believes that we are to continue the incarnation of God in the world. Like our Lord Jesus Christ, the church is to open up its arms and its heart and draw an ever wider circle all around people. So that reconciliation might occur with God, might occur within each one of us, and might occur with one another. We can learn a lot by listening to music. The composer creates multiple lines of beauty. Sometimes these multiple pieces of beauty clash. They each try to work their own way. You've heard this in musical pieces. They even battle one another for dominance. And what should be music sometimes has moments that seem a little more like noise. But when the vision of the composer succeeds, when the vision of the composer rules, the complex unity of the whole becomes even more awesomely beautiful than the simple beauty of each of the parts. The challenge for us might be to allow ourselves to be emptied of our own selves and to be filled with the glory and the wisdom of God. So what music will we make? Will it be to the glory of God? Will our playing it give mind to the hurting, to the forgotten, to the trampled, to the despised? Will our singing it bring a glimmer of light into dark corners and a glimpse of hope into despairing hearts? Will we bow? Will we bow to the wisdom and the vision of the composer? Will you? Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ even before the foundation of the world, to be holy and blameless before him in love. Amen.